Ga kulstul nu donito. Kulzun zumut I dati solito, vot sedan zuige. No, eh? Well, what about this? Ik ben een keunstalbouwer. Ik maaitje talen, omdat ik der not on ha. If you understood what I just said, you probably identify as Frisian. And by, just by hearing me saying this, you've probably made some guesses as to my own identity. In particular, by hearing my horrible accent, you probably made the correct, I must say, assumption that I am not Frisian myself. In fact, continuing to listen to me speaking English in the way I do, you're probably still carrying on trying to pinpoint my nationality. And by now, I wouldn't be surprised if you concluded that I come from France, but that my accent is light enough that I must have been living in another country for a long time, which is, by the way, completely correct, since I've been living in the Netherlands for more than 15 years now. See, simply by looking at, listening to language, you've made already quite a few guesses about me. So let's carry on talking about me and my relationship with my language. So, when I still lived in France as a child, I was taught at school that the language I was speaking was not correct French. I was taught that the language I was using to talk to my parents, to neighbors, my friends, and even everyone at school was rudimentary and debased, full of incorrect words and ungrammatical expressions. It might have been good enough to talk about the weather or to order a baguette at the local baker's, but it was definitely not fit to talk about important political, philosophical, or scientific topics. If I ever wanted to talk about these topics, I would need to learn the correct French language, a summum of logic and beauty that was carefully controlled by a group of old people with far too much time on their hands and a strange taste in clothing. And I didn't have it that bad myself. At least I didn't speak with an accent, or worse, a dialect. Had I done that, I would have been punished until I'd learned not to speak that way anymore. No, there was only one correct language for the Republic, and that was the French language that we all had to learn at school. A strange language, somewhat related to what we were used to speaking, but with strange words or even grammatical rules that we had never heard of beforehand, but that these people thought fit to force upon us. But I wasn't questioning this because I was just a child, but I was also fascinated with language, and I wanted to play with it, to experiment with it, to innovate with it, to see where I could take it, and being told in no uncertain terms that this was very much out of the question, that the only people allowed to tinker with French were the aforementioned sages, was a bit of a bummer. Well, of course, that very way to look at language is wrong itself. There is no right or wrong language, and there's definitely no language more logical than any other. And there is no language unfit to talk about some topics, as long as you've got the words. So quite simply, that's because language is the ultimate form of democracy. A language is simply a group of people who agree to understand each other. And that means that we are all allowed to do whatever we want with our language. Do as you please with it, it's yours. And that includes innovating with it. And by now you probably think I'm crazy, or you're having horror visions of how the youth nowadays or speaking incorrectly and or ruining your beautiful mother tongue with their slang and their text speak and their LOL and OMG. To which I just want to show you this. This is called the Appendix Probi, or Appendix of Probus. That's a document from the 3rd or 4th century AD, that's to say about 1700 years old, which lists basically mistakes in the Latin written at that time and in the driest way possible, I must add. In other words, this is someone's passive-aggressive rant about how their language was being ruined by rebellious youth. And all these mistakes, they were just the first signs that Latin was starting to change into what would become the Romance languages, like Spanish, Portuguese, Italian, or even that also logical and perfect French. In other words, the mistakes of one language became the standard of the next one. And this document isn't even the oldest document we have on these matters. It seems that complaining about incorrect use of language is just as old as language itself. I swear the first ever speaking caveman must have said to their first teenager son or daughter that they were saying "ugh" incorrectly. But linguistic creativity, that's to say the ability to innovate with language, to create new words, new expressions, even new grammatical rules, is actually what makes a language healthy in the first place. That a language that does not change is a dead language. And we are all in need to keep our languages alive, aren't we? After all, how else are we going to be able to talk about new stuff if we have to wait for stuffy old people to decide what to call it? Moreover, language is more than just about communication. As I hope I showed at the beginning of my talk, what you say communicates much more than just the ideas you want to convey. It tells the listeners also about your origin, your education, and more. This goes even further, and you may not be aware of this, but your language, the words you say, actually influence your mind. Take me, for instance. I am what you call a polyglot. I speak, barring accent, three languages fluently: French, Dutch, and English, and a few more conversationally. I am also a different person in these different languages. In English, I am pragmatic and conciliatory. In Dutch, I am emotional and opinionated. And in French, I am shy and introverted. Yeah. And you can ask any polyglot, and they will report the same experience, although they may not be, have the same changes of character with the same languages. That's a personal thing. Your language can even influence your moral choices, as a recent study showed. Language, then, is not just a mirror to your mind, a reflection of your identity. It is part and parcel of it. But let's go back to my story for a moment. After all, it's all about me, right? So I was there, a boy of 13, 14 years old, with this desire to play and innovate with language, while I'd been told in no uncertain terms that doing so with French was forbidden. So what was I to do with all that linguistic creativity inside me? Well, since I couldn't use it with existing languages, the only solution was to make new ones, right? And of course, I was not really conscious about it at the time, but that's basically what happened. I started making languages for fun and for experimentation to use that linguistic creativity in me that I couldn't use elsewhere. And I do mean that I created languages. I built grammatical systems up from scratch. I created words that were not related to words in existing languages until the results could well and truly be called languages. And while I thought at that time that I was unique in doing so, I discovered years later, thanks to the internet, And that was back in 1997. So for the younger ones in the audience, Google didn't even exist back then. I had to Alta Vista my way out. So I discovered that I was not unique. And there were actually thousands of people all over the world with the same hobby, a hobby they had come to call conlanging, for constructing languages, while language creators called themselves conlangers, for short. And the created language was called a conlang, yes. Ticket doesn't work well. A conlang, indeed, makes talking about this stuff much easier. But luckily, 2016 is not 1997, and language creation or conlanging has finally reached the spotlight. I mean, if you look at this, you probably know at least a few of the languages I'm showing here. At least Dothraki and Klingon, you probably have heard. Something like Quenya and Sindarin may not ring a bell, but you probably know them as the Elvish language of Lord of the Rings. And yes, there are more than one. But have you ever heard of any of these languages? Probably not. Huh? Yet each and every one of them is a fantastic achievement, some arguably even better designed than some of the more well-known ones. Actually, one of them is even designed by the creator of some of the more famous ones. And for the spirit of openness, I actually added two of my own languages in there. Not that I am claiming that they are fantastic achievements, but that was all about me. Huh? Now, what I want to explain simply is that there are thousands of people who create languages every day and have been doing that for decades or even centuries. I mean, the first ever recorded conlang dates from the 12th century. This iceberg goes very deep indeed. But why, you may be thinking now, why would one go through all that trouble to create a language that is probably never going to be spoken by anyone? And that's a fair question, yes. But the answer is in what I've been talking about in this talk, that language is not just about communication, or at least not just about the conveying of ideas. So there are plenty of reasons why one would want to create a language that are not about create a method of communication. Language, as I said, is an intimate part of someone's identity. Creating a language for oneself, then, is just the ultimate form of self-expression to use when one feels that existing languages just do a poor job at it. And indeed, many people create languages to better reflect who they feel they really are. For instance, that very first ever recorded conlang I mentioned, that's lingua ignota, or unknown language. It's a language created by a nun called Hildegard von Bingen, who's now a Catholic saint, by the way. And she wrote psalms in this language and songs, and she felt that that language better represented her relationship with God. And we know that it's actually a language and not just glossolalia, or speaking in tongues, gibberish, because we actually have documents like this, word lists that list words in lingua ignota and their translation in Latin. For a more recent example, see this beautiful illumination in Kardak, that's Mike Bacon's language. It says, sorry Mike for the pronunciation, Saikar odrindire juve kosen dit vas duadiras, which means, approximately, remember to breathe and know this too shall pass. Very appropriate for now. Of course, he could have done the same thing with English calligraphy instead, of course. But it wouldn't have had the same weight, at least for Mike himself, at least. So, and it might sound extreme to create an entire language, and here even a writing system, just to express oneself. But it's actually not that different from expressing oneself through body modifications, like tattoos or piercings. And I can tell you from experience that creating a language isn't as painful. Another thing about language being an intimate part of someone's identity is that it's true for fictional identities as well. Media companies now have budgets large enough to create beautiful sceneries unknown on this planet, intricate costumes and all the kinds of effects or artifacts that truly show how this fictional folk isn't from Earth. And then they speak perfect British English. Talk about breaking the suspension of disbelief. The truth is that audiences of science fiction and fantasy have now become sophisticated enough that having aliens who have never before set a foot on Earth speak English is simply laughable. And having them speak gibberish doesn't cut it either. So creating language for them is actually a relatively easy and cheap way to adding depth to these characters, especially if it's done well. See, for instance, this exchange between Khal Drogo and Daenerys Targaryen from the 7th episode of the first season of HBO's Game of Thrones, so don't worry, no spoilers.
So what's so nakal vosechi? Sani sofri vekayom? So vos so adarahari amni?
Vos sofro reshi.
Reshi, sek.
I don't know if you really understood what happened, but this exchange would not only have been less powerful in English, it would have been simply impossible, because we're seeing here Drogo correcting Daenerys' non-native and incorrect use of the word sorfo, which means dirt or spot of land, when she should have used raesh, which means land, nation. And a mistake she probably made because she had just used the word for earth, sorfosor. This is something you can't do in English. In fact, this entire scene really showcased the relationship between the two characters, and especially the affection that Drogo had for his wife, through his willingness to correct her mistakes as she learns his language. Also, you don't even need to understand the language, or even for it to be subtitled, for it to be meaningful to you. I mean, listen to this.
Ai lauri elanta lassi surine, in yar un notti narve ramar alloron, in yar velinti gul marvani er mior mar delessi miru voriva.
For the record, that's the beginning of Namarie, which means farewell. That's a Quenya poem spoken here by Quenya creator J.R.R. Tolkien himself. But you don't even need to understand the words to feel the nostalgia in the text, or even simply to appreciate the beauty of the language. So, and finally, I mentioned that linguistic creativity and how my being unable to channel my linguistic creativity in the realm of existing languages pushed me into creating new ones. That basically may be reason number one why people create languages. That's even true of Tolkien himself. He created his languages first, and only created Middle-earth and all the stories that happen in it because he wanted a place, a world, where his languages could be spoken. In that way, conlanging is just like any other art form. It's something just like the painter paints and the sculptor sculpts and the poet writes. Those who do it because it's in them, because it's part of their identity. And we create languages because that's who we are. So, before I finish, I want to show you the words of Edward Sapir, a linguist, who said, "Language is the most massive and inclusive art we know, a mountainous and anonymous work of unconscious generations." We are all language makers, as I hope I made it clear in this talk. Some are happy to stay within the confines of their own language or languages that they know, while some just want to use that creativity further. It's just another facet of who we are and what we are. So go and explore your own linguistic creativity. And I'm not asking for everyone in this hall to become a conlanger, although that'd be nice. No, but at least become aware of the creativity in your language, in the words you speak, and embrace it. Oh, and before we stop, those first words I said at the very beginning, eh? That's Moten. One of the languages I created and the one I spent most of my time and energy in. As for what does it say? Well, quite simply, Gal kursnulnu donito, kursun zumuti datis julito, votsedan zuige. No, no, okay. What does it mean? Well, as you can expect, it means kind of the same as what I said in Frisian, because you can't translate languages one-on-one. it means approximately, I am a language creator. I create languages because it's fun. Thank you.